So the second session of this conference zooms in on the global and national economy and how technology and science will shape these over the next few decades. Chairing this session is Professor Tommy Koh, who has forbidden me to introduce him because he says he is Gaginang, as in one of our own. He is special advisor at the Institute. So may I hand over this time to Professor Tommy Koh.
Thank you, Carol. There is a cultural difference between public speaking in Asia and public speaking in the United States of America. In the United States of America, it is expected of a public speaker that he will begin with a joke. In Asia, the cultural norm is to begin with an apology. And since I'm in Asia, I want to begin with a sincere apology. Professor Chan Heng Chi was very well qualified to chair session one, having been Bilahari's teacher at the university, professor of political science, ambassador to the UN and to Washington. I don't know why Janadas asked me to chair session two. I have no obvious qualifications to chair session two on the economy. But my fidelity to IPS is such that I never say no to them. So you must forgive me if I don't do a good job. So let me begin with just three simple remarks. What this session and what this conference expects us to do is to look to the next 50 years. And at breakfast this morning, when my wife asked me, what are you guys discussing at a conference? We said, well, we're looking at Singapore's prospects, opportunities, and challenges in the next 50 years. She said, isn't that a waste of time? My wife is my reality check. She said, just think back 50 years. Could we have foreseen the changes that took place in the world in the last 50 years? And I said, no, we could not have. Could we have foreseen Singapore's miraculous journey in the last 50 years? And I said, no, we could not have foreseen that either. So she asked me, on that basis, how are you going to anticipate what will happen in the next 50 years? So my first point, therefore, is the need for humility. I'm serious about this. There's a need for humility because it's so difficult for us to anticipate the dramatic changes that will take place in the world in the next 50 years. My second point is that one thing is for certain. We live in a region of the world that will grow in prosperity in the coming 50 years. And this is a big plus for us. We are lucky in that we are located in Asia, and Asia will rise in this century. And it will offer us many economic opportunities. If Asian leaders have the wisdom to avoid war and conflict, then the Asian growth story is a big story of this century. So that's my second point. My third point is that we are very fortunate in having two brilliant speakers for session two, as we did for session one. And each of them will try to share with us their particular insights. I want to introduce the first speaker, Dr. Byron Auguste. Dr. Byron Auguste is a brilliant young American. He graduated from Yale with a BA summa cum laude. He was awarded a Marshall Scholarship, which took him to Oxford University, where he did his master and doctoral degree. He then worked in various places, including McKinsey. And for the last 2 years, he's been helping President Obama in the White House as the Deputy Director of the National Economic Council. He's currently working for an organization called Opportunity at Work. It's a civic enterprise aiming to rewire the US labor market in ways that will enable more Americans to achieve upward mobility in the job market and workplace. So it is with very great pleasure that I invite Dr. Byron Auguste to speak to us.
Thank you, Professor Koh. I agree with your wife. Economists are notoriously bad at predicting the next business cycle, far less the next 50 years. And who would have predicted in 1965 that a tiny, poor island nation with no natural resources and a per capita income on par with the newly independent African countries would boast one of the highest per capita incomes in the world 50 years later? On the other hand, who would have predicted that we'd still be sitting in traffic jams? We were supposed to have flying cars. We don't predict the future well today, in part because it won't be an extrapolation of today's technologies. It'll be shaped profoundly by the choices that we have yet to make as individuals and families, as managers and entrepreneurs, as artists and inventors, as citizens and policymakers, as countries, and in the wider community of nations. The larger question I'll address this morning is how coming changes in digital technology will intersect with human talent, learning, and work, and how this intersection will affect the goals of social justice and cohesion. In particular, I will focus on economic opportunity, defined as conditions favoring the achievement of the widest possible range of people to increase their earning abilities, their choices for employment, enjoyment, and investments in the future. And so now, in the best tradition of Asian speechmaking, as I very recently come to understand it, here is my apology in advance. I, for the next few minutes, will oversimplify that which is not so simple. I will make the case for things that I cannot prove. And I do not, in fact, have a crystal ball. So you're now all warned. So to the question, what advances economic opportunity in an already advanced economy, such as the US, Britain, Japan, or Singapore in 2015? First, productivity through innovation. Second, participation in meaningful work. And third, sharing in the rewards of one's own labor. So, what does technology change mean for, and what does the future hold for, these three preconditions of economic opportunity? In a newly developing economy with an underutilized workforce, additions of capital, labor moving into the formal economy, education, foreign know-how, good governance, and access to markets can help catch you up on productivity pretty quickly. In advanced economies, though, innovation matters most. For example, in the US, the impact of capital investment and educational quality have roughly been constant in productivity terms since 1945. All the swings in productivity growth in the US have come from that blue bar at the top, which are changes in total factor productivity, which is really just an economist way of saying innovation. Innovation in processes, products, and practices, such as all the research and experimentation to pack ever more microscopic circuits onto each microprocessor, the net result of which we call Moore's Law. Like the new smartphones in our pockets, industrial automation in our factories, or advanced medical devices in our hospitals made possible by those very same chips. Or like the dozens of fabulous chip design startups to create new video, speech, and other specialized processors that were made possible only by the creation of highly specialized semiconductor foundries pioneered in Taiwan to build and rent out advanced process technology to small companies to produce chip designs. All three types of innovation produce higher value out of the same resources. Now, the pace of innovation in digital technologies is accelerating. While the radio took 38 years to reach 50 million users, Facebook and Twitter did so in 1 year or less. Uber, a software platform to match car riders to drivers, has attracted thousands of drivers in city after city in just a matter of months. And a combination of advanced software, artificial intelligence, and predictive analytics will revolutionize the discovery of new cures and personalized medical therapies, the efficiency of natural gas extraction, and other fields unrelated to iPhones or social media. In particular, innovation in our vast, typically less productive services sectors is the key to growing our economy-wide productivity at a faster rate. But despite this enormous potential payoff, deep concerns have been raised about how these innovations will affect the second element of economic opportunity, participation in the workforce. Of late, there's been a lot of commentary that can be summed up as, the robots are coming, and they're coming to take your jobs. Technology has been changing the structure of the workforce for over 200 years. Mechanizing farming and automating factories have not actually reduced the overall need for workers in two centuries. However, there are no guarantees that the future will resemble the past. In their book, Race Against the Machine, Eric Brynjolfsson and Andrew McAfee of MIT talk about the second half of the chessboard in artificial intelligence and automation. They refer there to the power of its exponential improvement with the parable of a king who agrees to reward a helpful wise man with grains of rice, starting with a single grain that double on each square of a chessboard. By the second half of the chessboard, through the power of exponential growth, the king has emptied his kingdom's granary and surrendered to the wise man all of its wealth. By the second half of our chessboard, in the next 50 years, we will have autonomous vehicles providing riders with safe, convenient, self-driving fleets. Millions of professional drivers can be replaced. There will certainly be new jobs created in fleet management, in-car entertainment, and many others. But we don't know which jobs, how many, or for whom. For many, that's a very frightening prospect. And how wide a range of human work will the exponential growth in computing networks and software platforms replace with more efficient machines? Will automated checkout replace human shop workers? Will music be composed by software that has analyzed every song ever played? Paradoxically, in 50 years, machines will likely perform very well on many, if not most, of the job tasks performed by humans today. But yet, I also believe that we can keep machines as the helpmates of people, rather than our masters, if we use them not just to automate tasks, but also to complement our human strengths, our creativity, intuition, empathy, our asking questions, new questions, to find new answers. Garry Kasparov, the Russian chess grandmaster, and in 1996, the first human world champion to lose a match to the chess-playing supercomputer Deep Blue, once told me of a 2005 experimental chess tournament that allowed anyone to compete online in teams composed of other people or computers, or mixing and matching people and computers. Now, while Deep Blue, one-on-one, could still overpower the best human chess player, accomplished human players, paired with ordinary computers, actually beat the most powerful supercomputer, which shows us, I think, that humans can create new strategies to race with the machines, not against the machine. But let's not forget how such changes could affect the third element of economic opportunity, the share of income earned by ordinary workers. Since 1973, the US, and to some extent most advanced economies, have seen a bifurcation in job creation, with jobs created rapidly in creative, highly technical, and expert managerial services, and also in less skilled, lower paying jobs in locally delivered services, like personal care, elder care, sanitation, security services, but with much slower growth in middle income, middle skilled jobs of all kinds. So I believe the two most fundamental risks to consider stemming from this otherwise extremely welcome boost to our innovation and productive potential are first, the possibility that many existing jobs will someday be eliminated much faster, even in knowledge work, then our companies find new ways to profitably employ people. Note that not that where people could be productively employed, but where our system finds ways to profitably employ them. Second, the possibility that digital innovation will super empower knowledge workers who race with the machine, but leave those with task-based algorithmic jobs in the dust. Now, in an ideal future, these three elements of opportunity, productivity, participation, and sharing the reward, would all go hand in hand. There have been times and places where happily they did, growing large middle-class economies. In recent years, advanced economies have seen each of these elements challenged and often decoupled. For example, three recent eras of economic opportunity in the United States have very different profiles along these three elements. On the left, from 1948 to 1973, rapid annual productivity growth, 2.8% a year, modest workforce participation, but a rising share of national income going to the broad 90% of US families lifted the fortunes of most working Americans. In the middle, from 1973 to 85, US productivity growth fell in half. Just as dramatically, the share of income going to the broad 90% fell by 9 points. That's about $1 trillion US dollars in today's economy. It was like trying to run up a down escalator. And finally, from 1995 until last year, US productivity growth rebounded to 2.3%, but workforce participation stalled, then fell to its lowest level since the mid-1970s. An upward distribution of US income continued as the bottom 90% shed another 6-point share of national income, 2/3 of which went to the top 1%. Now, details differ, but the big picture is similar worldwide. In advanced economies, the three facets of economic opportunity do not improve or necessarily coincide automatically. Choices we make in public policies, in business practices, and societal adaptation matter a great deal to our future path. I would add that not to choose is also a choice. So what path will we take? At the risk of tremendous oversimplification, I would contrast three scenarios. Scenario one, the Luddite reaction. Many people around the world are deeply uncomfortable with a path of technology that automates the only jobs they know how to do, whether or not they are offered retraining or state benefits to find another way of life. As we consider our choices, it's always worth remembering that work is not just a source of income and purchasing power. Work is also a source of personal meaning, identity, of pride, and independence. These photos from last week are French taxi driver protests against the Uber car service. The French government has now banned Uber. But if this is a protest against software that matches passengers to human drivers, what will the protests look like against replacing human drivers with self-driving cars? What's technically possible is not inevitable. Imperial China, at the time the most technologically advanced economy on Earth, abandoned long-distance seafaring in the mid-1400s. Since then, political or societal concerns have stopped innovation in its tracks many times in many places. Second scenario, the metropolis scenario. The classic 1927 German film, Metropolis, is set in a future dystopian city where wealthy industrialists rule over an exploited underclass of laborers who dwell literally underground. This fear of a vast gulf between rich and poor, is echoed in many movies of our time, such as Gattaca in 1997 or Elysium in 2013. I offer this not as a movie critic, but because science fiction echoes the fears of the times in which it's created. In 1927, when Metropolis was made, the wealth gap between the richest 1% and the average citizens of Western countries was the greatest it had ever been. In the US, this disparity peaked in 1929, never reaching those levels again until 2010, 5 years ago. We're reaching a critical moment of fear that social justice and even civic cohesion cannot be maintained in the face of self-reinforcing disparities in income outcomes and opportunity. So now I want to describe what I believe can be a third scenario, how to unlock economic opportunity via a word that I haven't used much until now, talent. So the third scenario is one in which we manage to unlock a new surge of broad-based productivity based on talent, human talent, intelligence, and motivation that are vastly underused today. This is the scenario in which we all learn to race with the machines. Now, we may not go down this path, but I firmly believe that it does exist. The potential to accelerate economic growth on a far more equitable and balanced path of opportunity is hiding from us in plain sight. So why do I believe that tapping human talent can be our solution? First, because human talent is the most underused natural resource on our planet. Humans can learn both faster and more than we know. For example, children have an amazing unacknowledged talent to teach themselves. In an experiment made famous in a TED talk, Professor Sugata Mitra of Newcastle University embedded a computer in the wall of a slum in New Delhi and found that the children, without any supervision, could teach themselves how to use it. Repeating this throughout India, he saw children record their own music and even teach themselves to speak with neutral British accents so that a speech-to-text program could understand them. These untapped talents can be amplified by education. The best human tutor can consistently increase their students' performance by 2 standard deviations, for example, from the 50th percentile to the 98th percentile. Artificial intelligence and big data may allow everyone to have such a digital tutor. Stanford professor Carol Dweck's insight that to simply teach students that their own intelligence is like a muscle that can be grown through exercise rather than a fixed ability boosts their real academic performance. This has been repeatedly validated in randomized experiments and implemented in learning curriculum such as Jump Math, which has doubled mathematics performance in many Canadian schools and has begun to spread worldwide. Believe it or not, the untapped talent potential may be even greater in adults. The opinion research firm Gallup has measured employee engagement across the world using a 12-question survey where respondents agree or disagree with statements like, I have opportunities to at work to learn and to grow. Gallup finds that just 13% of workers are actively engaged worldwide, that is, working with passion. In fact, almost twice as many workers are actively disengaged. They're not just bored at work, they're bitter and actively sabotage their companies. You may be happy to know that the number of bitter Singaporean workers is far lower than the global average, but you may be less happy to know that the number of engaged Singaporean workers is also lower, at 9%. I'm sure it includes all of you, however. Using its massive data set, Gallup finds that moving from bottom quartile to top quartile employee engagement results in a 21% boost in productivity, 25% less turnover, 37% less absenteeism, 41% fewer defects. Now imagine the economic impact of tripling the share of workers that are truly engaged at work. But finally, and most profoundly of all, innovation in business models to create new, highly competitive, and well-capitalized institutions to optimize the economic return on talent and the public policies to support the emergence and growth of such institutions can make human capital a more consistent engine of productivity growth. My former colleagues at McKinsey Global Institute just issued a report on what they called online talent platforms, which are an emerging class of technology-enabled enterprises which help students, job seekers, and employers to understand the demand and supply of skills, efficiently match job seekers to work, build work experience, and allocate training resources more optimally. These include fast-growing companies like LinkedIn, Glassdoor, Uber, and PayScale. MGI forecasts that by 2025, these platforms can increase worldwide labor market productivity by $2.7 trillion, mostly by expanding participation and reducing periods of unemployment. And that's only from the better matching of talent to work. This does not include the value creation potential of deploying cognitive and learning science via new technology. So the question is really not, does the potential exist? The question is, do we have companies, do we have systems, do we have markets, do we have incentives to realize that potential? I worked at McKinsey for 20 years. I worked with dozens of companies. The work we do and the work of the S&P 500 and its counterparts around the world is focused on optimizing the return on invested capital. That's how you serve the shareholder. Invested capital is the capital that companies can own, their machines, their buildings, their software. We don't measure human capital or human potential very well, but it might easily be two or three times the value of invested capital in the balance sheet of countries, but we don't have the institutions to optimize them. This is a major challenge for public policy in the next 50 years if we're going to realize this talent scenario. So I'm not just talking to you about this, I am doing something about it. 3 months ago, I co-founded Opportunity at Work, a social venture to address US labor market dysfunction. Starting with information technology, IT jobs, of which 600,000 are unfilled today in the United States, we are working with 21 cities and hundreds of employers to do the three things that we believe can change this market. First, together with local government, civic and business leaders, we've started with the White House sponsorship, the Tech Hire Initiative, to bring together a critical mass of employers to agree to hire mid-level and entry-level information technology job positions based on competence, demonstrated competence, whether or not an applicant has a typical job history or the formal credentials they would normally be looking for. In other words, if you want to know if someone can code, don't ask to see their resume or their transcript. Ask to see their code. Second, to ensure that employers can find those workers with the skills but not the academic pedigree, by spreading nonprofit hiring on-ramps like Code to Work and Launch Code and creating more robust markets for high-quality accelerated training programs. You have a concentration of these programs in places like New York and San Francisco, but through this Tech Hire Initiative, they're spreading to Nashville and Chattanooga and Delaware because employers there are coming together and saying, we have the need, and they're working together. They're sending a demand signal. These hiring on-ramp organizations also assess the skills of non-credentialed workers on behalf of employers and translate job postings from degrees and resume items to actual skills. And third, we're partnering with major talent technology platforms for skills self-assessment, job matching, and human resources best practices so that employers' HR and IT departments can more easily understand and assess and adopt their preferred paths to finding and investing in talent on a more inclusive basis. We're just getting started, but ultimately, we believe this work has profound implications for public policy, for how we finance education and training, how we incentivize employer practices, how we regulate new talent platforms to encourage a healthy path of growth and ensuring access to those pathways for students, workers, and job seekers of all backgrounds and all income levels. When President Obama announced the launch of the Tech Hire Initiative in March, he recognized LaShawna Lewis, pictured here. Born in a poor East St. Louis neighborhood, LaShawna learned to code before she had to leave university after her first year due to life's exigencies. Despite her skill, she was unable even to get a job interview to be a software developer or a programmer, so she worked as a bus driver and in a call center for over a decade. Today, LaShawna is a systems engineer at MasterCard after being matched by hiring on-ramp Launch Code, Opportunity at Work's partner in St. Louis. This is good for LaShawna because she's found the job of her dreams, she earns more, and she's deeply engaged and loyal. MasterCard filled an important job with a great talent, and it now realizes it doesn't matter how she arrived there, and it's trying to hire dozens more LaShawnas. I'll end this talk on a personal note. A few years before Singapore became a nation, my 17-year-old father-to-be set sail from his island home of St. Lucia in the Caribbean because there was no work. His travels eventually brought him and my mother to Detroit, Michigan, once the Silicon Valley of its time, but by then had seen better days. In 1972, my father saw an advertisement for a training program to learn a computer language called COBOL for IBM mainframes, at which there was a shortage of programmers at the time. My dad did not have a university degree, but he nonetheless quit his job as a factory shipping clerk and studied hard for 6 months to learn COBOL. Happily, he mastered it, and he did get a job as a computer programmer, in fact, a series of jobs that brought the Auguste family into the American middle class. Our story had a happy ending, but it was not an inevitable one. Many non-obvious choices made that possible. With government support, IBM decided to invest a huge sum in basic research and development before it knew for certain that there would even be a commercial market for computers. An entrepreneur realized that companies and universities could not train computer COBOL programmers rapidly enough and decided to start a business that succeeded by converting students' talent and motivation into newly marketable skills. Desperate for these new skills, employers decided that they would hire anyone who could do the job well, whether or not they had a college degree or had ever worked in an office. And with my mother's moral and financial support, my father decided to take a chance, quit his job, and learn something new on the hope and the promise that it would bring a better life. None of these choices, these decisions, can be taken for granted. And so too will the future of economic opportunity, of technology, talent, and social justice depend on our entrepreneurial creativity, the open-mindedness of our business practices, the wisdom of our policymakers, and the self-confidence of our people in the face of a changing world. If there's one thing I've learned in Singapore in these past 2 days, in conversations with policymakers, thought leaders, educators, hotel desk clerks, and drivers, is that you will surely make decisions with great care and execute them with great diligence. I hope that you will also be as creative as you are careful, and that you will have much success and much to teach the world. Thank you.
I thank Byron for sharing with us his family's personal story. I would not be wrong to say, Byron, that you are a poster child for the American dream. I would briefly summarize Byron's contributions in the following way. His major point is that in America, the productivity growth has come mainly from innovation. And his second point is that we should not fear technology, although technology can destroy jobs, but we should view the machine as our helpmate. And we embrace the future by making technology an instrument that leads to innovation. I find his three scenarios very interesting. And just to summarize, the three scenarios are, number one, the Luddite scenario, which is to oppose technology. And you gave us an example, the recent decision by the government of France to ban Uber. So obviously, we shouldn't embrace this scenario. Your second scenario, which you call the metropolis scenario, is one that leads to a very exclusive growth, where a few people are extremely wealthy and the majority of the people are not benefiting from the prosperity. So you also reject that. Your third scenario is the scenario that I guess you want us to consider adopting, and you call this the talent scenario, by which I think you mean we need to focus on the development of skills and to bring about a positive confluence between technology, human talent, and an equitable outcome. Yeah. Thank you very much. I can't help but thinking that if I look at the United States today, I'm very troubled by some recent trends. The U.S. economy is recovering, but it's a jobless growth. You still have very high unemployment. And according to your own data, in the last several decades, U.S. middle class income has seen a progressive decline in household income, you know. So I guess my question to you is, what lessons can we learn from the economic conditions of the United States today? Jobless growth, a declining trend in middle class income. The next speaker, Ravi Menon, is a very good friend. We spent 2 years together negotiating the free trade agreement with the United States, and I'm a fan of Ravi Menon. Ravi graduated with an economics degree from the National University of Singapore. Then he proceeded to Harvard University, where he earned a master's degree in public administration. He's had a brilliant career in the public service. He was Deputy Secretary of the Ministry of Finance, Permanent Secretary in the Ministry of Trade and Industry, and he now holds the important job of Managing Director of the Monetary Authority of Singapore. Ravi, can we have your views, please?
Very good morning to all of you. Delighted to be here. And first, I want to congratulate IPS for organizing this very timely and forward-looking conference. Let me say at the outset, I am not here to talk about Greece. Often the things that occupy our short-term attention are not the most important things that we should be concerned about. So I'll keep to the script. I'll be talking about Singapore's economic future, or more appropriately, the factors that I think will drive Singapore's economic future. Talking about future, I mean, hearing what Tommy's wife just had to say, I have now finally solved one great mystery. I now know who or what is behind the great wisdom that Tommy often displays in settings like this. And so with that warning at heart, I'll be very careful, as Byron was, calibrating the degree of certainty I can say things about the future. In fact, I think it's basically impossible to predict the future. The best we can do is to take a stab at identifying the drivers or factors that will shape that future. And so here I'll take my stab. What I think will drive our future the next 50 years, these are not the only things. It assumes a lot of other things are given, that there is peace, there is an absence of conflict, and there is no global pandemic and other disruptions that we can all well imagine. And I'm sure in other settings we actually have to discuss and try to get a better understanding of. But here, ceteris paribus, economists have a penchant for assuming away all other things and focusing on what they prefer to focus on. So from that context, I think the three important things that will affect our future. One is Asia and China. Two is technology and skills. And three is a social compact that will evolve in the coming decades in Singapore. Let me start with Asia and China. This is a well-known story, so I can be quite brief. Notwithstanding the short-term risks and vulnerabilities we see, Asia's long-term growth prospects remain bright. Several reasons. The region is poised to be the fastest growing and most dynamic variety of factors at play. This is a chart that many of you have probably seen and illustrates how the global center of gravity has been shifting towards Asia. This version is based on McKinsey, but there are other versions which show slightly different locations of where that center of gravity is. But generally, the trend is from west to east. It starts with the 1820, when China and India were the biggest economies in the world, and the center of gravity was somewhere just north of Tibet. And progressively, with the Industrial Revolution taking force, that center of gravity in the world, the economic center of gravity, which is the geospatial center of the world if the world was weighted by GDP or output. That center of gravity has been shifting steadily westward. At its peak, it was somewhere off the coast of Iceland, because that represented center of gravity of the North American and Western European powerhouses. And then it has now been shifting back towards the east. And projections are that by 2025, it'll come back quite close to where it started 200 years earlier, slightly north to the border of Xinjiang, really expressing the weight of China's economy and the rest of Asia. There is scope for faster productivity growth. Most Asian economies are still far behind the frontier represented by the US. And the ASEAN four, and this is of particular relevance to us, Malaysia, Indonesia, Thailand, and Philippines, are on a steady growth trajectory. There will be occasional mishaps and interruptions on that trajectory, but the underlying drivers of growth are intact. Continued investments in human capital, not as much as they ought to, but ongoing. Continued investments in infrastructure, also not as much as they ought to be doing, but there is still a fair bit going on. This will increase the supply capacity of the economy, and on the demand side, the rise of the middle class will create a confluence of demand and supply feeding on each other, people being able to afford more middle-class goods and services. Two important points to note about Asia's growth. There's much being said about the slowdown in growth in China and also in other parts of Asia. But I think what matters is the absolute growth in demand from the higher base. China's going to grow about 6-7% on average over the next 10 years. Now, this is not as strong as the 10% that China had in recent decades, the last three decades. But what matters for the rest of Asia and the world is the increase in demand in absolute terms. And this is what that chart tries to show. In 2004, when China was growing at about 10%, that 10% represented $180 billion of additional output each year. 2014, at 7% growth, but on a much larger economy, much larger base of output, that's about $300 billion of additional new demand each year coming out of China. So yesterday's 10% is today's 7%. The incremental impact on demand for goods and services across Asia and the world is larger today. Second, it's not just the growth in demand or headline GDP growth rates, which most of us are concerned with, that matters, but the changes in the composition of that demand. Sustained rise in incomes is expanding the middle class throughout Asia and spurring demand for a very wide range of goods and services. This is a phenomenon that many consumer firms are very well acquainted with. At what point do people buying shampoos in large quantities? At what point do people buy television sets? At what point do people take up life insurance? At what point do people go on overseas travel? There is a middle class threshold crossing which the demand for a large number of goods and services just expands, and in many cases exponentially. And the ADB estimates that by 2030, China, India, and the ASEAN countries together will account for almost half of the middle class population in the world. This chart shows what they will buy. Economists have a concept of the income elasticity of demand. What are the goods for which demand will increase by more than the increase in income? If your income goes up by 10%, you're not going to buy 10% more food, probably 7%. But if your income goes up by 10%, what will you buy by more than 10%? Travel is one of them. Financial services is another. Business and professional services. Information communications technology. Because once the more basic goods have been consumed, these are the items for which the income elasticity is greater than one and for which demand is going to grow. And this has great implications for the rest of us in terms of what will we buy from each other so that we can produce the right things. Singapore's integration with Asia must deepen and expand. And I would say in two important regards. First, we need to go beyond trade and manufacturing to trade and services. Tourism, medical tourism, education, they're already flourishing due to lower barriers. And as the region integrates further, it is other service industries, such as business, legal, and creative industries, that must be progressively opened up so that we can have a shared prosperity in which the benefits of integration and specialization and exchange are maximized across the region. A second aspect in which our integration needs to go much, much more than what it is today. We've conditioned ourselves to think of trade and integration largely in terms of exports of goods and services and imports of goods and services. But I think the integration that Singapore, especially as a small country, needs to think hard about is the export of capital and people. Internationalization efforts are already underway. Many of our firms are overseas in the region, and they are paying off through a steady flow of income accruing to Singapore-owned entities today. About 22% of GDP comes from income from abroad, from the operations of our capital and our people abroad. You look at Switzerland, it's 35%, another small country that has been very successful in this. So there's a long ways to go. And I think in the future, if we are to ride on the Asian growth story, this is an absolutely important thing, that a large part of our productive capital and human capital would have to be deployed overseas. And imagine a future where our GNP is 30% larger than our GDP, or what is generated domestically. Technology and skills. Two questions about technology's impact in the future. Will it sustain growth? What does it mean for jobs? Will it sustain growth? There are two views now in the among economists. It's one of the hotly debated issues. There are the techno-pessimists and the techno-optimists. Techno-pessimism, best exemplified by Robert Gordon. I would strongly urge you to read his paper. It kept many of us awake at night worrying about the future. Basically, his main point was that you are seeing a marked decline in transformative technologies. Now, everyone knows there's a lot of innovation going around. Everyone knows there's a lot of new technology coming on stream. He's not arguing that. He is saying that the major transformative technologies we haven't seen for a long while. His argument that our best innovations may be behind us. Techno-optimism, Eric Brynjolfsson and Andrew McAfee, Byron mentioned them, authors of Second Machine Age and Race Against the Machine. Their main thesis is that we are on the cusp of major transformations arising from the proliferation and convergence of several technology trends that are taking place, and this will sustain productivity growth and economic growth throughout the world. Two very different views, but looking at the same trends around us. The first story, will technology sustain growth? Why Gordon thinks no? And he shows this chart, which shows the growth in real per capita GDP. There was a surge following the Industrial Revolution, sustained through the second Industrial Revolution in the early part of the last century, and then coming down very rapidly throughout the developed world. And if you look at the examples he cites, between 1900 and 1960, we went from traveling by a horse and buggy to taking a Boeing 747. Now, what's happened since the Boeing 747 60 years ago? Not a great deal. Fundamentally, the jet engine, the internal combustion engine, even battery technology to store energy and electricity have not moved a great deal. They have moved, but not by the quantums that we used to see in the early part of the last century compared to the previous 100 years. And he makes a point that recent innovations such as the internet pale in comparison with the invention of electricity. Gordon additionally cites four headwinds that will inhibit growth in the coming decades: demographics, education, debt, and inequality. Demographics of the four is the most certain. It's the rapid decline in population growth and labor force growth will have a strong effect on real GDP growth, and this has been seen in several economies across the world. The other argument, technology will sustain growth, and that what you have seen is not an aberration in human history, that what you have seen since the Industrial Revolution is a fundamental discontinuity in the path of human progress and technological innovation. And this chart shows the level of per capita of GDP per capita rather than the growth rate. And this is the main argument that McAfee and others make, that they have these new technologies have as much potential as the inventions of the past to transform the world. It's just going to take a bit longer. I will not dwell on this. Some of these new technologies, Byron touched them on briefly, robotics, 3D printing, clean energy, genomics, big data, learning machines. Very interesting things happening on each of these fronts. Anyone thinking about the future, anyone running large organizations, anyone making policies, anyone teaching a course in a school or a university, or anyone thinking of applying for a course in school or university would do well to keep abreast of what's going on in some of these areas. This is going to impact our lives greatly. In what ways, I can't say. Will all of them affect our lives? I can't say. But looking at what's been happening on some of this, I would lean towards the view the technology is more likely to transform our economies and sustain growth in the future than not. And there's no strong basis for that belief except a belief in human ingenuity and enterprise. But we would all do well also to keep Gordon's article and paper at the bedside just to remind us things may not turn out that way. What does technology mean for jobs? Now, assuming technology becomes a key driver of growth, what will it do for jobs? If you look at the earlier industrial revolutions, they have destroyed jobs on a net basis in the short term, but created jobs on a net basis in the long term. I think the more important question, and I think Byron touched on this quite well, is what kinds of jobs will technology create, and what kinds of jobs will technology destroy? I think that's a more sophisticated and nuanced way of looking at it, rather than ask, will it create or destroy jobs? Obviously, we'll do both at the same time. More importantly, it will change many of our jobs. And we need to ask ourselves in what ways they will change. Routine, repetitive tasks, is that one way of classifying jobs and to ask ourselves if they are replaceable by computers and machines? Analytical and processing tasks, conventional wisdom until a few years ago, the so-called white-collar services jobs were fairly safe from technological advance, which automated blue-collar work, but that's being challenged today. Machines are now gaining increasingly sophisticated cognitive capabilities. They can do pattern recognition. They can act upon information through algorithms, and algorithms that learn from experience and interactions with the real world and with human beings in ways that can match and in some cases surpass human flexibility and agility of the mind. Then there are the creative and empathy-based jobs, maybe the last bastions of what makes us essentially human, which, at least for now, we think machines can't do. Community work, a good part of it, I think, will fall into this category. Arts and the media, nursing, all manner of therapy, and jobs in engineering, in legal, which help to combine both creative and social skills, which technology will not replace, but technology will change those jobs, the nature of those jobs, where technology can be an ally to some of those jobs. So this is not so much about being replaced by machines, but how we can work with machines. And we need to reframe those questions in our organizations and in our policies. And useful exercise to do will be to ask how each job will be changed by technology, stretched to its limits, and what role can humans play to add value to those jobs working with machines, because it must be that a combination of man and machine must be better than a machine alone or a man alone. And what matters will be skills rather than content, and capacity rather than content. And education may have to be redefined. I will not go into the details because I think Byron did a very good job of explaining how some of the way in which we prepare ourselves for the future, our young through education, and equally and more importantly, I would say, our workers through ongoing education. I would just say that the standard way of thinking of learning as a sequential process will dramatically change in the future, very highly likely to change in the future. that learning and working will be much more intertwined, and many of our conventional ways of dividing the two will disappear. The third driver, social compact. This is important because this will determine the policy orientation of our society and our economy, and that will determine growth. And this is important also because the distribution of income and wealth will become key issues. They already are key issues, and they'll continue to be. That's not going to change very quickly. And we're interested in that not just because of the consequences for growth or even social cohesion, but as our society advances and matures, because of what it means for the moral dimension of our societies. What do we mean by a just and fair society? Question is, what should we be concerned about, equality or mobility? What matters for social justice? We need to distinguish the two, because even if inequality remains high, there is very likely going to be a reordering of the decks. If some of what we just discussed earlier about technology and skills comes to pass, then many of the jobs in the middle are going to, many of those who hold those jobs are going to slip below. Many of those who hold jobs at today's bottom of the income ladder may well move up to the middle. And I think we're already seeing some signs of this in the United States, where there's talk about a hollowing out of the middle with the advance of technology. And jobs that hitherto were regarded as lower down the income ladder, higher demand. So you're going to see a reordering and mobility, but the gaps may still remain, even if the gaps are between different groups of people now. There are two views on this. Milton Friedman offers the very traditional view, the conservative view, if you will, that inequality does not matter as long as there is opportunity to succeed and there is social mobility. And a certain degree of inequality is unavoidable and actually desirable under an economic system based on free enterprise and individual effort. In fact, there is a conviction amongst many people that income inequalities that stem from inequality of opportunity is the problem, rather than inequality of outcome per se. There is a counterpoint to that. Can you distinguish the two so separately and clinically? Alan Kruger, former president of the Council of Economic Advisers, makes this point. Will there be mobility if there is inequality? Are the two related? And higher income inequality may well lead to lower social mobility in subsequent generations because of the effect they have on starting positions. So the bottom line is, even as we focus on equality of opportunity, as Friedman advocates, and not try to achieve equality of outcome, we cannot entirely ignore outcomes because they determine outcomes in the opportunity in the subsequent round. How can we sustain an opportunity society? This is the subject of, you know, a conference in its own right. I think there are things that we ought to think hard about by way of interventions. Upstream is the best. The more you can do in terms of upstream interventions to as best equalize opportunities as you can, the better the prospects of creating a society of opportunity. Early childhood education, something we've started to do in Singapore, is often touted as one of the most effective ways of doing this. And research shows that providing children from lower income families access to quality education will raise the stock of human capital and reduce the need for future income support. Second is ongoing efforts. And this is what I referred to earlier on as lifelong learning. We will need to invest as a society a lot more in continuous education, upskilling, and training. The traditional way of seeing the education budget as separate from the worker training budget, I think, is going to be increasingly challenged. And by this, I don't mean just internships and apprenticeships, but whole systems of learning where there is transition between school and work on a lifelong basis. You may well want to imagine a future where university degrees may have an expiry date, because basically they're quite useless 20 years after you receive them. And continuous education certification requirements may well mean that to maintain that status, you need to learn both on the job and back in school or other institutions that are equipped to do this. So this might be some of the things that we should be prepared for in the future. However much we do on upstream, we cannot ignore that we'll need to also do more downstream, and that there will still be inequalities of outcome that the market produces. And to make sure that opportunities continually get restacked and re-equalized to the best that we can, transfers to lower income households will have to become a major part of the future social compact. And studies show there's a large difference in effectiveness and outcomes between an equal resource policy, which invests the same amount in everyone, and an equal opportunity policy, which invests in people in such a way to compensate for differential social circumstances. Something as a society we need to think hard about. And this brings me to the last point about community support. And this is the most important point about social compact, I think. We often think of it as compact between people and government. That's how the popular narrative is often portrayed. But I think, in a sense, government is only an intermediary in the fiscal process. The real social compact is between those who have done well and those who have benefited from the new economy, and those who have not done as well, and those who have been left behind. That is the true social compact. Because if that social compact is strong, then it is a base, it gives legitimacy and a basis for a more redistributive fiscal system, which governments will be more confident of doing, and also community support, volunteerism, and so on. But if that social compact is not strong, and in many parts of the world it has been shown not to be strong, because what really causes problems of unsustainability is not help for the poor per se, it is middle class entitlements. And if our society needs to create an opportunity society, then the help that we give has to be concentrated to where it's most needed, where they're most disadvantaged, so that things can level up, and not a society where there's a sense of entitlement that everyone needs to. So that, I would say, is the most important part of the social compact that will determine outcomes in the future. Thank you very much.
I thank Ravi for a very substantive and very wise presentation. I think the two presentations are complementary. Ravi has made three important points. Point number one, about the fact that we live in a region of the world that will be characterized by growth and opportunity in the coming decades. Second, he's a techno-optimist like Byron. I think on balance, he feels that that technology will sustain growth and create opportunities. Unlike Byron, his emphasis is not on talent, but on skills. And I suspect that you, Ravi, probably played a role in helping DPM Taman Shanmugaratnam in conceptualizing our new Skills Future initiative. And we want to talk about that. And your last point is a very important point and talks about equity. What we want to create in Singapore is an opportunity society. I think that you share that too, right? Ravi, you were not here earlier when Kishore spoke, so he wants me to remind you that this conference is not organized by IPS alone, but also by the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy and by NUS. So members of the media, can you please reflect this in your report tomorrow? So my I'd like to begin by asking Byron a series of related questions. We often look to America as a model, but it's a very troubled model. Yeah? Since the 2007-2008 financial crisis, there's been a gradual recovery, but it's a jobless recovery. And according to your own data, in the last 2 to 3 decades, household income of American middle class has progressively declined, you know, and inequality in the year 2010, I think, right, Mm-hmm. In America, it's as bad as 1929. So you've got many problems, no? So can you give us some good news?
Yes. Well, I can give you some good news, although, because it's a mixed bag. I would say the U.S. economic recovery can no longer be described as a jobless recovery. I mean, I think the job, you know, you're having about 220,000 jobs created a month. I think it's now somewhere in the neighborhood of, you know, 15 million plus sort of jobs that have come back. So the jobs are coming back, and I think to Ravi's point, the decline in labor force participation is probably at least half due to an aging population and the way that you'd expect it. Now, the other half, some of that is cyclical, but some of it is structural, and I think that part is troubling, but I think you could exaggerate the degree to which it represents just a fundamental problem. And I think there's tremendous examples, I mean, even during this, this great recession, of enormous innovation, things that 10 years from now, 20 years from now will be, you know, enormous companies, new ways of doing work and the like. So I think a lot has been happening. That said, I do think there are a few real problems. The first, actually, in a funny way, is a reduction in the dynamism of the U.S. economy. And I would start there, because while there are pockets of enormous dynamism, there are very large sectors of the U.S. economy, healthcare being the biggest one, where productivity growth has been poor, incentive structures are poor in many places, you know, infrastructure is another area, many places where these intersect. There's been decline in new business startups, and I would observe in the labor market, there's been a decline in voluntary job mobility, where someone quits their job and goes to get another job. And classically, that's been half of wage growth has been the result of somebody shifting jobs on purpose. I mean, that's what a market is supposed to do. It's supposed to work not just for employers, but for the individual, too, to optimize their talent. And that's declining. And I think that there is a short-termism, both in our public sector governance, but also very much in our corporate governance, where you see now almost 100% of corporate profits in aggregate are spent on dividends and buying back shares as opposed to productive investments. So something, I mean, obviously they're extremely dynamic sectors of the economy, but something's wrong when you're not seeing those opportunities. And so I would emphasize that as much as the issues of inequality. And in fact, I think the slowdown of dynamism has hurt the most people trying to move up. That said, the final point, and whether you call it talent or skills or education or whatnot, I believe there is really an appalling neglect and lack of seriousness about human capital and the value of that, and equipping people with that, you know, throughout, from birth to throughout working lives.
Thank you. Thank you, Byron. Ravi, can I ask you a question? I want to suggest to you a worst-case scenario for Singapore and how we can position ourselves to cope in such a scenario. In a dialogue last evening, Prime Minister mentioned that we have the world's second busiest port after Shanghai. Let us assume that global warming continues, the polar ice cap will melt, and an Arctic route become navigable throughout the year. Let us imagine that the much discussed canal across the Kraal isthmus takes place. Let's imagine that aircraft manufacturers will build aircraft that can fly nonstop from Sydney to London, and I'm not sure, Man Leong, what we're going to do with Terminal 5. Let's imagine that we go the way of the United States and most other advanced economies, with the exception of Germany and Switzerland, that we begin to lose our competitiveness in our manufacturing sector. and we increasingly depend on service jobs. How do we cope in such a scenario?
You very well know I don't know how to answer that question, right? I'm sure these are some of the things that CAS and PSA would, you know, be worrying about. And you're quite right. A disintermediation of our trade, of our transport hub role, seaport and airport, because of changes occurring elsewhere, has great relevance from a historical perspective. If you look at many of the city-states of the past, Venice and so on, this is one of the reasons why they went under, because of the changes in navigation routes that completely intermediated these ports. So I think those are real dangers. In fact, I think in terms of air hub, it could be even more because the idea of an air hub itself is not necessarily a very robust one. Shipping, I think there's a stronger case where you have a hub and you break bulk. But air transport is mostly passengers. You want to get as quickly from point A to B. And as more flights take place direct point to point, the hub and spoke advantage that we have will diminish. But this goes into every other economic activity. Changes take place and you get disintermediated. You then have to figure out what is your next source of strength. And if you look at manufacturing and electronics, that has been happening over the last 40, 50 years. Entire industries have hollowed out and offshored. If you look at the structure of manufacturing today, with just 20 years ago, it's very different. The size of manufacturing has come down, no doubt, but the composition has changed dramatically. And even within electronics, we used to be the world's largest producer of disk drives, very little done now. So I think that transformation will have to continue to take place. And so interestingly, in the area of transport hubs, what will be the value that we can add? And we have to think about the networks of information that surround the globe and the role that we play in that. Can we be a switching center? A center where, which can add value to some of this, and we should not disregard the role that service industries can play. We have a large part of our economy in what you call traditional services, which are low value adding and low productivity, and there's a lot of scope to do better on those fronts. They don't need to languish behind manufacturing and modern services like financial and business services. And if you look at the even the productivity levels of the service industry in the United States, it's retail and wholesale markets, and it's hospitality sectors. We have a long way from that frontier. So I think there's tremendous scope for catch up. And then once you've closed that gap, then you have a different set of problems, which is how are you going to have new innovations to project the frontier further.
Thank you, Ravi. It's time to hear from you. There are many brilliant economists in the room, and I was hoping that people like Ravi, Manu Bhaskaran, and then Professor Houston Kwa. Can you go to the microphone? Manu Bhaskaran, my personal economics tutor.
Thank you. Hardly. Thank you, Dr. Auguste, for a very interesting discussion of how key innovation is to the next economy. And it makes me very concerned because if you look at the innovation indices around the world, ranking various people, Singapore looks very good in terms of the inputs we mobilize for innovation, but not very good in terms of the outcome. So when you calculate an innovation efficiency index, we are somewhere right at the bottom, struggling to match Burkina Faso and West African countries. And that makes me worried about the future because the capacity to innovate, I think, is critical. And it shows, what this shows is that we do not have the ecosystem to convert innovation inputs into outcomes. Secondly, in a world economy that is increasingly putting emphasis on scale, our regional hub, unlike Hong Kong, which has a huge scale opportunities from the Pearl River Delta in China, or even Bangkok, which is increasingly leveraging off the scale opportunities of the Mekong region, we don't have an immediate regional hinterland that gives us the scale to bring unit costs down, become competitive. So we have two big challenges, the ecosystem for innovation and this lack of scale opportunities for our regional hub. And I'd like to understand from Ravi how policy is going to respond to that. Thank you.
Thank you. Let's take another question. Professor Houston Kwong is the editor of a new book, which will be launched very soon. It's on Singapore in the year 2065. So you are the ideal person to ask a good question.
Thank you, Professor Koh. Thank you, Byron and Ravi, for making the insightful comments. Yes, I was actually going to mention that, not about specifically what goes in the book, but rather that the fact that the book deals with Singapore from the year 2065. So I wonder what Mrs. Koh will say to that. Okay, I have a comment basically in a question. We have been talking about the United States. We know that United States productivity has been increasing, but wages and jobs are in fact stagnant. Even in college graduates, they are not getting their share, or they perceive a share of the growth of the income, and therefore income inequality is beginning and becoming a big burden, a big concern. This simply means that there will be a lot of social tension, and if we do not manage this social tension, we are going to tear down whatever that we have built up. Now, you have mentioned some aspects of what we could do, unlocking talents, engagement with employees, and so on. But I was wondering, all these things requires perhaps more and more government intervention. Government must play a definite role in trying to lead this, to fund this, to correct, and so on. But with more and more government intervention, you're going to get more regulation, more direction, and perhaps less creativity, less innovation, and so on. And this creates difficulties. So I was just wondering, what is your view on that? My second comment has to do, perhaps, can be shared between Ravi and Byron, which is that most governments give safety nets to the classic group of the poor and the old. So what about safety nets to give to those in the younger age group between, let's say, 18 to 25 or 27? That is to let them experiment, let them innovate, let them, you know, explore. Now, this age group is very curious and passionate. And in advanced economies, the young would have this opportunity much more than, say, in Asia, because they are more risk-takers. And why they are more risk-taking is because they are able to have these safety nets, less obligations and burdens, family burdens. So what? Now, if you look at Asian society, there are more and more affluent families. The children actually are able to take on more of this risk, and some of them succeed, some don't. But why not encourage it from the state perspective and give more safety nets to a wider group of families? And finally, to Ravi in particular, I think while most of us can agree with this lack of transformation technology, but do you think there is a failure, not just in the college education, the way we teach our students, but also what about research funding and research direction? I think that's a bigger problem. Thank you.
Thank you, Houston. Maybe I'll call on Ravi first. Ravi, two questions for you, and then on Byron.
Yeah, thank you. Good questions. Manu asked about the ecosystem for innovation, and this is still not where it should be. I think the central part of that ecosystem has to revolve around, again, not so much what is government doing. I mean, there's a multiplicity of schemes and programs. It's the organic relationships between small firms and large firms. That's what works beautifully in America. And you see pockets of it in Singapore, but not on the ecosystem scale. I think that's where we need to focus our attention. Most of the innovation, and this is documented repeatedly in studies, takes place in small firms. But they don't have the scale and the market and the outlet to operationalize and to commercialize those innovations. And then they have tie-ups, and they work through the large firms, and then they themselves become large, they IPO, they have a life of their own. That is the ecosystem we need to create here. And I think in the industry that I'm more familiar with, in the financial sector, you see very interesting applications of that, the so-called fintech phenomenon, where you have many non-financial firms, technology firms, who are providing financial solutions and financial services outside of the financial sector, in a very narrow field, but in a very value-adding way. Many of them are actually ex-bankers who lost their jobs during the crisis and then took up technology and found that they can actually, you know, offer certain things more cost efficiently. And you're seeing interesting cross-pollinations now between established incumbent institutions who are afraid of these small players and have gone out of their way to tie up with them to see how we can produce solutions. And this is how innovation takes place. And we are working actively to bring these two people together. Sometimes it happens naturally. Sometimes you need a bit of nudge and a bit of system support to make that happen. But I think you've hit on a very important point. The ecosystem for innovation is not the absence of ideas. If you go to Ayer Rajah Industrial Estate, you would see lots and lots of small chaps doing all kinds of very interesting things. There is, and so those rankings that put us at the top of the innovation leagues are not wrong. But you're right, we have not been able to translate that yet. But it's still early days. We will get there, I think. The second point about scale opportunities, I think, is a bit more worrisome. There are large segments of the economy subject to scale considerations, and you see that in manufacturing increasingly. As more of it becomes robotized and automated, scale becomes a critical factor of production. And we have seen that in some of our manufacturing activities where we've lost ground because of not having scale advantages. But at the same time, there are many other activities, manufacturing services, consultancy, after sales, R&D, testing, certification, where actually scale does not matter as much. And if you look at the parts of the manufacturing sector we're doing very well in, it is those parts. They may not employ as many people though, but they do extremely well. Because you're seeing two trends in the economy, one that favors scale, and the other one, precisely because of the same technological changes, that focuses on customization, something that the machine or a mass scale production can't deliver, but something that's customized to my needs. You see that in manufacturing, you see that in services. And again, more familiar with financial services, there are some activities in financial services that are going to be commoditized and mass produced, and may well be provided outside the financial sector. But the increasing focus then will be on the customized solutions to meet individual needs, where human person-to-person contact becomes important, and small is beautiful. So I think there are two trends going on, worrying to some extent, but I think not a hopeless situation. Houston's question about safety nets in order to take risk, I kind of can't understand, because the whole point of risk is there are no safety nets. So if there are safety nets, then you have taken away the risk. So it's always an oxymoron in Singapore, you know. Government must provide more safety nets and support for entrepreneurship. Well, the whole point of entrepreneurship is to take risk and bear the consequences of failure. But I think more broadly, you're right. The social structure here is one where one takes on lots of obligations which makes the consequences of failure much higher. I think I would put it that way. The consequences of failure are higher here because of family obligations, because of the rather uniquely Singaporean drive to own your home as soon as you get married, which is very uncommon in the rest of the world. Most of the people I know in other parts of the world, especially in the developing world, relatives in India, for instance, the whole point of working is at retirement to be able to afford a house. I think it's good that we are doing better than that, but this rush, headlong rush, creates obligations that can stand in the way of some degree of risk-taking and taking some risk in the early part of your career. And I think that's something you've put your finger on quite a relevant issue there. Thank you.
Thank you. Byron?
Yeah. Well, you had many good questions. And I'd say first that please don't interpret anything I said there that I focused on to say that there are not other policy issues that are important for the outcomes we want, because there are many. And none of us have addressed, for example, the relationship between concentrations of wealth in a society and then concentrations of political power that follow it and that often are used to sort of warp the system so that you don't have a level playing field and that, in fact, wealth then can be generated through rent-seeking rather than through innovation. And I think that's a very real risk that we should take seriously, but that's a discussion for another time. To your question about the United States labor market and college graduates, first of all, I think it is much exaggerated the difficulties of college graduates. I think a far more, in fact, still have very low employment rates. I'm not saying they're not issues, but I think the problems are, first, that many people attend college, take on debt, and don't graduate. There are 35 million Americans who have attended college but do not have a college degree, and they earn only a little bit more than high school graduates. Secondly, I think colleges are not, for the most part, they're not really optimized for learning. And here I'm not saying sort of skills, STEM skills versus a liberal education. Even those skills, those qualities associated with a liberal education are not measured and are not validated. And in fact, what we do is the financing system is to strap a lot of money onto the backs of an 18-year-old or 19-year-old and say, hey, go out in this very complicated system and figure out how to spend it. The person who's least able to judge, the sort of the best route bears all the risk. And I think that's a difficulty in the system. You asked about whether changing this would require more government intervention. And I think it is very much now in the U.S., education through student loans are very, it's a big federal government role, although ultimately individuals pay that, most of that. In the workforce, I mean, in the U.S. government, there's $20 billion a year spent on training programs. U.S. companies spend $500 billion a year on training, 25 times as much. So it's actually far more important, to say nothing of their payroll and who they hire. So what really drives these outcomes is much more employer behavior than it is government programs in that context. So the question really is, how does employer behavior evolve? And where government has an information problem. The government does not know what skills are needed in the market, and if it knew today, it wouldn't know a year from now because they're constantly changing. So it's very difficult for government to intervene directly that way. On the other hand, that information, which is in companies, is widely distributed, and there is a really severe collective action problem, and companies don't have departments of collective action. So for an individual company to decide whether they are going to try to poach a worker that's already trained and already working at another company or hire a new one and train them, that might be an easy decision to just poach the worker. But if all companies make that same decision, then you'll have a gap, a major mismatch, no matter what higher education does, by the way, because there are many, many skills, most, I would assert, that you need to work to learn. You can't just learn at school and then to work. So that is very important, and I think in most places, Singapore's thinking a lot about this, but most places are not thinking nearly enough. And then I just want to add that the question about unfettered free markets assumes that actually innovation right now is running sort of roughshod without a regulation. But I think that's not true at all. In an earlier, Ravi, when you talked about the scenario of slowing, the techno-pessimism, the Robert Gordon piece, I mean, what that data shows, I think, is not that technological innovation is not advancing, but rather that the deployment throughout society is not advancing. And the very example of the airplanes and the 747, well, the fastest plane we ever got was the Concorde. Mm-hmm. And that was what, 40 years ago, 45 years ago? Mm-hmm. And what's happened to the Concorde? The Concorde doesn't fly anymore, and we've never tried to build faster commercial planes, not because the technology wasn't available, but because of the sonic boom. It made a loud noise, and neighbors living near an airport despised it, and they lobbied against it, and so it doesn't work. Is that a failure of technology? Actually, what that is a quiet, silent, Luddite reaction. In a way, if you think about it. I mean, what's actually happening in many areas of innovation is because we land this innovation and say, what's the impact it's going to have if everything else we do the same way? well, it's going to be very inconvenient for some people, and it's going to cause problems. And so it actually quietly slows down in many cases. And so I think if we were more creative about thinking what else in our system do we need to change for this innovation to be a positive, not only in the aggregate, but for all the people who matter, I think we would make far more progress. And I think that's very possible to do in the context of the labor market because there is so much value to be tapped in people. And finally, I would say, if you have a growth model that is based fundamentally on talent, talent is far more widely distributed than is opportunity. It's far more widely distributed for sure than is capital. And so if you have a model that's based on really helping people make the most of their talent, that's where the economic drivers, then you don't need to do as much redistribution after the fact. Whereas if you have an economic model that's optimizing capital, which is highly concentrated, and then you try to figure out through the political system how to redistribute that, I think most political systems will break in trying to accomplish that.
Okay. Thank you, Byron. We're out of time. Carol, where are you, Carol? Can I have more time, or should I bring this to a close? Bring it to a close? I apologize to my friends in the audience who wanted to ask questions. I'll be very brief in my summation. I think I'll use Ravi Menon tripology and say, point number one, we are very fortunate to be located in a region of growth and which has very bright prospects for the next 50 years. The burden is on the political leaders to ensure that Asia's success story is not aborted by war and conflict. The second point on technology, I'm very pleased that both Byron and Ravi are techno-optimists. They think that we should embrace technology, that technology can be a helpmate, not our threat, that technology can produce innovation and jobs and higher income. The third point is by Ravi is very important, which is that the social compact, that what we want to do, I think, in Singapore and in America is to produce an equitable society. And we want to produce an opportunity society where we try to intervene and level the playing field for people from the poorer families. I think I want to make the important point that we can't predict the future. So what can Singapore do to position ourselves? I think it is to maintain some of the pillars of Singapore's success story. Continue to support free trade, open economy, welcome foreign talent to Singapore, strong rule of law, non-corruption, and educate our people well. In our schools, in our junior colleges, in our ITE, in our polytechnics, in our universities. And let us make this mindset change that we need in order to make Ravi's new initiatives, Skills Future, success. Because I think if we don't succeed, I'm actually not optimistic that we can retain our manufacturing sector. Yeah. So thank you very much.